शिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। I welcome you all with my love and respects. Again today we have a very apt sutra exactly on which I delivered my morning message, and today whole day we were working. I feel literally Patanjali is just flowing with us, or we are flowing with Patanjali, because exactly the subject which we touch in the morning and work whole day, here is Patanjali giving the sutra. It cannot be just ordinary coincidence. The today's sutra is again on attachment. Thoughts plus attachment is engram. Engram minus attachment is thought. When there is no attachment, the simple thoughts not only will not disturb you, any ordinary happening, even crossing master's breathing space, those thoughts will just be burnt away. See, when you are attached only because your will is added to the thoughts, master just wants to respect your privacy and freedom. He does not burn it away. This is all right. You are enjoying it. Why to disturb you? Leave it. But the moment he understands there is no attachment, there is no your involvement, that solves the whole problem. He interferes and burns the whole thing. That is what Patanjali calls as jnanagni daktakarmanam krite. The fire of knowledge just burns the seeds of engrams. See, attachment is nothing but you saying yes or no to a thought. Please understand, yes or no to a thought, nothing else. I can define more precise way: inability to cope up with insecurity is attachment. Understand, it's like your life is like a roller coaster. When you are unable to cope up, you wanted some settlement, some settled feeling. That is where the attachment starts. See, you are not bothered about hell. Whether it is hell or heaven, you wanted to be certain about it. Understand, that is the truth. You are not really, really worried about hell, because the hell you are in at this moment, your inner space, the hell in which is it is there, that is the worst possible hell can happen. The bound consciousness with which people suffer, that is the worst hell. You are able to manage even this, means nothing more can be done to you, don't worry. You are not bothered about hell or heaven. You wanted to be sure about something. But the life is such, constantly it puts you in uncertainty. It's like a it is not the failure about which you are afraid of, the fear of failure which creates the fear. That is what really makes you worry. You are worried about that. If you are certain about the things, then it's great. But by the very nature of kala, time, he will not let you be uncertain as long as you are in his control. The time's basic quality is movement. See, the greed's basic quality is leaving after it is fulfilled. The fear's basic quality is staying after it is fulfilled. And time's basic quality is just moving whether it is fulfilled or not. Understand? If you grasp the basic qualities of fear, greed, time, it is liberation. Nothing else. It is liberation. Especially understanding about time, kala. The other day I was seeing a documentary in YouTube. The Einstein's understanding about time, kala. He is the closest experience of time happened in the modern day after Kalabhairava. See, Kalabhairava is a rishi. Rishi who has experienced completely the truth of time and mastered science of managing time. Who has given us the science of going beyond time. Understand this truth very deeply. Your attachment is nothing but your deep seeking for stability, your inability to cope up with changes. That is what is attachment. But unfortunately, what to do as long as you are in the shaft of time, till you master time, this is the basic suffering. Nobody can be responsible for it. You just need to become Kalabhairava. Work on time. Till you master time, nobody can help you. It is inevitable. Then comes the great depression and low mood. I think it is not for me. It is not going to be by me. That is the success of time. It is not as difficult as you go on thinking. Start practicing satya. Means having the ultimate understanding as yours, please understand, there are three pramana scale to measure the truth. One is shastra pramana, what is described in the works of an enlightened rishis, incarnations, like Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita, Brahma Sutra, those literatures, that is called Shastra Pramana, works of the great masters. Second is Apta Pramana, the words of a living master who is initiating you, who is in front of you. आप्त प्रमाण, थर्ड इज आत्म प्रमाण, युअर ओन एक्सपीरियंस. वेन यू हियर द शास्त्र प्रमाण, इट शुड इंस्पायर यू टू मूव टुवर्ड्स आप्त प्रमाण, फाइंड आउट अ लिविंग मास्टर हु विल वाउच फॉर शास्त्र प्रमाण. द लिविंग मास्टर विल बी पुशिंग यू टुवर्ड्स आत्म प्रमाण, your own experience. Now I am pushing you towards your own experience. Start satya, practice of satya means the ultimate possibility of you is you already. So go on remembering. Send a clear, strong Facebook note to all your friends. I am enlightened from now. No, I am telling you, it's the truth. Just send a strong note. Hey, I am cosmos. They will ask, have you experienced? Don't worry about that. I am telling you, I am. You don't need to bother about that. I am telling you, I am. Now you have to act. No, really, conscious faking it will be making it. It's one of the key I'm giving you. No, really, unconscious faking only will not make. Conscious faking it will make, be making it. I tell you, many of your sufferings are you not believing your ability to be in that beyond suffering. See, there is a ultimately one layer of real breaking, but that one layer of real breaking is very easy. It's like one egg is hidden inside 100 bag of cotton. Breaking that egg itself is not a big job. It is just one knocking, one finger work, but this 100 bag cotton removing is the real job. Now practicing satya will be the satya, as I am telling you, will be the removing of the 100 bag cotton. You guys are caught with 100 bag cotton, which is not the reality. So the next process you are going to do is go and tell all the social media in which people are available to and you are available to people, I am enlightened very clearly. Understand? How many of you trust that I know more about you than you know about you? So for all of you, I am declaring you are enlightened. Tattvamasi, that art thou. Tattvamasi, I am giving you initiation now, this moment, 6:20 is the moment I am giving you initiation. Understand? The Amnaya Patati, the Diksha Patati, which prescribes the rules of initiations, very clearly declares any initiation master gives, any declaration he makes, he is responsible for completely completing on all actions of commission, omission you do till it is completed. So knowing the Diksha Patati, the procedure of initiation, the rights and responsibilities of a master who is initiating, and the rights and responsibilities of the process of initiation, I am initiating. So all the actions of commission and omission by you, till you experience the reality of what I am talking to you, I am responsible. So go and send a message, I am enlightened. From this moment, send this message to the cosmos. See very clearly 21 points of your body which sends and receives information. The leg, 10 points. The hands, 10 points. The Sahasrara. tell very clearly and send this message through these 21 points. Release this message. I am cosmos. I am enlightened. The person who knows me much more than me has clearly declared. Till 619, it was only Shastra Pramana, means teaching of the rishis. But by 620, it has become Apta Pramana, my very master's words. Fortunately, unfortunately, it is already heard by this ear. It has fell into this ear and made sense into me. So any word which has fallen into your ears and made sense to you, I am responsible. So it is clear now. Your mind has no way of escaping saying still you are not enlightened. I am sealing all possible escape routes of your mind. And if your mind discovers any other possible escape route, now itself I am sealing all those which I uttered, unuttered, legally, formally, dharmically, socially. Understand? Now I am telling you, Tattvamasi. You are that. And let your body and mind start clearly declaring. Now this moment, tell cosmos, Aham Brahmasmi. Because I heard already the truth of Tattvamasi. I am knocking at your Anandaganda, breaking at your Anandaganda, the door of the Anandaganda, with this hit of Tattvamasi. Thou art that. Thou art that. So when I break your Anandaganda lock, the door of Anandaganda, with the truth that art thou, it opens with the truth Aham Brahmasmi, I am that. So now I am declaring clearly. Now open it, break it, open it. I think opening, breaking and all is two small words, explode. Aham Brahmasmi. Let every part of you practice this satya. Shake all your family, friends, declaring, I became enlightened 620. 620. In the live session, I have been given enlightenment. So now it is Atma Pramana. Over. Start living. Just start living. Nothing else. Nothing else. When you break, when you explode, see, do all the things which creates insecurity in you. Oh, I will tell everybody, not my mother and father. That will be too risky. They will create chaos. No, tell them first. Create all possible chaos in your life with this declaration of enlightenment. That is what I call courage, dhiraha. Shurasya dhara vishitani kecha. The path is like walking on the racer's edge. Now I am putting you on the racer's edge. Come on, declare it. Over. This moment, send through this 21 point to the cosmos. Aham Brahmasmi. And when the session is over, send it through social media. Aham Brahmasmi. And start living that way. There will be a huge upsurge of fear to hold on to something stable. Just boil that small chicken which is trying to hold on to something. When you break this egg, you will see now your so-called little bit of remaining ego will jump here and there, will try to hold this part, that part. That's what headless chicken. And no, I am okay, it's okay. It's okay, but I think, Maybe after this program, I will become enlightened. No. I think, see, he is giving me as a technique. If I do it, after 10 days, I became, no. I'll become enlightened. Nothing doing. You are now. You are now. That's all. You are now. The ultimate possibility of what you think can happen to you is now. So no doors for mind can be allowed. Simply start living. Change your liver as enlightened liver. That's the last part in your body which will change. Now tell your liver, you are enlightened liver. Your blood flow will change as an enlightened within 5-10 minutes. This liver only will be the last one to change. The intellect. Liver is directly related to pitta, intellect. That will be the one which will take some, at least 1 year. Tell your liver, you are enlightened liver now. That is the strong biomemory. Liver is the place where the strongest biomemories are stored. Now, your liver should understand you are enlightened. That is the essence. That is why, actually, when samana is balanced, the levitation. When the prana is balanced, floating on water. When the udana is balanced, the whirling, which is the pure intellect. The liver will be cleansed. When the vyana is balanced, the whole, all remaining parts of your system will be cleansed. So the liver is the most difficult organ in your body, most strong biomemory of your body, which resists for this breaking of aham brahmasmi. Tell your liver now. Put your hand on the liver and tell, hey, you are enlightened now. Your liver is the part which needs to learn the lesson. And tell it, it will listen. Now that is the only resistance, nothing else. See, you don't have a big enemy. Your enemy is simple physiological enemy, not psychological. It is physiological. It is just physiological. It's simple liver, nothing else. That's the truth. So the inability, see, it's like a, when you are going through the roller coaster, you want to hold on to something. That is what is attachment. No need. Just be comfortable with the whole roller coaster. Just be comfortable. Just be a Kalabhairava. Nothing. Do not have constant search for stability. Do not have the constant search for stability. That's all. Nothing else. So now, any moment some part of you says, no, I may not be enlightened, then put your hand on the lever and say, I am enlightened. Keep quiet. So actually fight is not between you and your ego or mind, fight is between you and your liver. Now that is the truth. Find out the right enemy. Don't fight with wrong enemies. Don't bother about anything else. Just whenever anybody shouts, don't answer them. Talk to liver. Liver will tell, no, I don't know, they are doing. Now, I am not interested in you, whether you know or not, you stop saying, that's all. That's all, nothing else. Your liver, responsible for pitta, is responsible for all the effuria. That's all. because I am declaring I am incarnation in macrocosmic level, the whole human society is trying to resist. Unconsciousness, collective unconsciousness trying to resist. Because you are declaring in the microcosmic level that you are enlightened, the microcosmic level unconscious is trying to resist you. That's all, nothing else. So now do the same thing I did. First, create Facebook and declare, I am enlightened. 6:20, August 31st, in Chitsabha, in the presence of my master, Paramahamsa Nityananda, I received the truth of Tattvamasi and declaring it as Aham Brahmasmi. Understand? The big confusion will happen is, have you experienced for declaring? Understand, now I am breaking an important truth. You, Hindu tradition does not believe in enlightenment experience. It is Buddhism which brought the idea of enlightenment. Hinduism has no enlightenment. Tell me a single Upanishad which talks about enlightenment. No. Hinduism talks about only one thing. Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. Listening, internalizing, living. That's all. Vedic tradition does not require enlightenment experience. You all belong to Vedic tradition. So you do not know, need any 360 degree or internal opening or breaking of the coconut or anything. All you need is my declaration. In the Vedic tradition, all you need is Shravana and Manana and Nididhyasana. Means listening, internalizing and expressing. So, by the authority, as a living incarnation, I am declaring, you have completed Shravana, listening, Manana, internalizing. Simply doubt, now do Nididhyasana, living. Understand? No Upanishad, no Upanishad talks about enlightenment. You may be shocked, what is this? Then what were we doing all these years? You need to know, no Upanishad talks about enlightenment. They are all very clear. Truth should be listened, internalized and start living. That's all. When you start living, there will be some breakthrough point which is marked as enlightenment by Buddhist tradition. All the idea of Vedic, idea of enlightenment you find in Sanskrit literature also is post-Buddhist Vedic literatures. Not pre-Buddhist Vedic literatures. I want you to know, only the post-Buddhist Vedic literatures are influenced by the Buddhist concept of enlightenment. So, you do not need to bother, think, worry, that you need to get into some state, only then you have the right to declare you are enlightened. No. I am telling you, as living incarnation, I have the right to declare you are enlightened. And with that right, I am declaring. You just start living. Anybody asks, anybody creates beyond your stability some doubt in you, say, I don't know, he told me. That's all. That's okay. Whether it is internal or external, lever or representative of the lever outside. Sometime your own lever can fight or your lever's representative outside, who has a big lever outside, he can also fight. So your liver or your liver's friend liver. Anybody fights with you, whatever answer your logic knows, you know answer. If you are not able to handle, just hand over the problem to my liver. Tell that guy said, what can I do? Have the master's photograph, that is the master card. That master card will do all process in our world. So try whatever you can play. When you feel no, you are not able to handle, just show the master card. He told, I don't know, talk to him. That's all. I am very clear, I am not giving this as a technique to you, no. I am giving this as a truth to you. It is initiation into satya, not initiation into dhyana, no. Not initiation into practice, no. Initiation into truth. Just start living. Whoever will not believe you are enlightened, convince them you are enlightened. Just convince them you are enlightened. Because those fellows are your internal voices. They are all having little area in your liver. If your liver is 100 acre, each fellow is holding 5 acre, 10 acre, 7 acre real estate. And the moment I put the truth, they are all fighting. The truth is like a football, I am dropping, but your liver is so crowded, they don't allow that football to land on your liver, they are just kicking by hand. And sending that back to me. But now I am not going to take it back. So clear at least 4 or 5 fellows real estate on your liver, that's enough. Once the ball lands on your liver, then nothing can be done. So slowly all other fellows have to vacate and leave your liver. That's all is the truth. That's all is the truth. Attachment is the silently saying yes to all the fellows who are sitting on your liver, who go on promising stability but never deliver it. Your liver is occupied by so many people, including your priests, politicians, society, family, friends, and everybody. Every fellow is promising you stability. But nobody can deliver. And you go on trusting him. That is attachment. Attachment is trust placed in wrong place. Nothing else, that's all. I think I have given you clear technical information on attachment. Let me enter the sutra. What Patanjali says, very beautiful word. Sukanu sai ragaha, that's all. Sukha anusai ragaha. Vivekananda translates this sutra as, attachment is that which dwells on pleasure. Dvivedi translates this as, that which dwells on pleasure is desire. Swami Sachidananda translates as, attachment is that which follows identification with pleasurable experiences. Purohit translates as, desire is the longing for pleasure. I'll give my understanding. Sukha अनुसायि रागाः when you don't go through even the pleasure completely because of your insecurity and trying to make stability out of that pleasure movement, the unfulfilled pleasure experience, which is a hangover in you, which makes you feel that you need to become stable in pleasure, is attachment. Understand? When you try to be stable, when the pleasure happens in you, because of your nature of trying to have stability on any movement, because of that fight, you do not enjoy the pleasure. Because you do not enjoy the pleasure, it leaves an hangover in you. That hangover again insists that you should have that same pleasure intensely. That instigation to have the same pleasure intensely so that you can be out of this hangover is attachment. This is the definition for fear and greed. Trying to find, feel stability. How can you? Because the very field in which you are feeling is time, which is a constant movement. The more you are ready for instability, more higher realities are revealed to you. More your nervous system is ready for anything, the more greater realities are experienced by it. The more your nervous system is ready for insecurity, the more secured space is experienced by it. The more you are ready to face the fear, more fearlessness happens to you. That is the whole fun. Paradox of life. When you are comfortable with the paradox of life, you are in paradise of life. Paradox leads to paradise. When you have fear of paradox, paradise never happens in you. सुखानुसायि रागः I can give you one more technique, one more process. Do not respond to your fear or attachment. Just go on teasing it. Let your mind sit in front of you like a baby and tell, I want this, I want this, I want this. You tell, okay, what else you want? No, get me now. Okay, what else you want? Just sit with your mind and have a baby play. And it will cry, no, now I want in 10 minutes. Okay, what else you want? Come and explain. Let him do all kinds of dance and play. I am depressed. Okay, what else? Then? Great. Then? No, no, no. I am having this fear and insecurity is going to happen next half an hour. Oh, then? You think that Swami's teachings and technique is going to work on you? I'll see that you forget all that. Then? You think you are enlightened? Come on, 2 days be in this mood. Third day morning when you get up, I'll take care. Early morning. Come on, let me see early morning whether the Swami comes first or I come first. Then? And it will be so irritated. Just clutching the teeth. I'll see that you step out of this campus, I'll take care of you. Then? It will be a great thing like a Tom and Jerry. Really? You think you are so much courageous. All right, how many technique and method this fellow teaches works on you? Come on, let me see. Then? Have a school face. Then? Maybe you can have small artificial liver. Really? A plastic lever and keep it. And mention on in the pen, sketch pen, father 2 acre, mother 2 centimeter, and the ex-husband 2 centimeter, and the present relationship 4 centimeter. Like this, keep. So all those fellows, collective voice is your name, your ego. And tell, then? In the body language of that liver, you will see the shade of all your family, friends, relatives, body languages mixed. Shouting like uncle, face show like your aunt, screaming like your spouse, hitting like your ex-spouse, you will see all of them there. All you need is then. It will say, come out of this campus, I'll take care. Then you are typing and sending message in social media, I'll take care. Then just go on saying, this fellow is hypnotizing you, you don't understand, he's brainwashing you, don't you understand? Then, washing the brain is great, which I cannot do, he is doing it for me. What's the wrong in it? When there is somebody to pollute the brain, there should be somebody to washing and cleaning it. Is it not? Understand only one thing. You have nothing worthy that master need to take it from you by exploiting. That only gives you the complete courage to stand by master's words. As I said, nothing worthy. If you think there is some worthy in you, go out and try to work it out. Then sometime you will understand it is nothing worthy, then come back. That's the truth. there is nothing in your body or mind and the byproducts which can come out of body and mind is useful for him. Whatever you have is nothing but the grass which the sheep lion can bring for the lion. The lion may put that grass into the mouth not for eating, just to satisfy you that you are accepted, you are wanted. The other day I was talking about that Krishna's romance. That's the greatest sacrifice Krishna can do. See, I know, I have experienced the inner space of Krishna. It is not easy joke to make the other person feel that he is respected, he is wanted, he is enjoyed. I can say in this whole galaxy of avatars, incarnations, Krishna is the only person who has successfully able to make the other persons feel that they are wanted. Still, I am not able to make anybody feel. That is a big problem. See, everybody whom I just give my love or my care, they all know it is out of compassion. Then that one line that they are wanted never is felt by them. But Krishna is a great guy. He is able to make feel, gopis really feel he is in love with them and they are wanted for his happiness. That is something extraordinary. The ultimate sacrifice. Still, which I am not able to do. I know there are so many people whose whole life is filled with the devotion, joy and love, but they all know my response is only compassion. I do not need them in my life. That line itself is a kind of a distance. But Krishna, I can say, the compassion which is beyond Buddha, where gopis really felt we are needed for his pleasure. When really, really, no way they can add 1 inch to Krishna. But his compassion, he came down to that extent of making them feel that they are needed, so that they will feel they are wanted. It is something extraordinary. Extraordinary. Unimaginable sacrifice. Anybody I hug or bless, they know they are not needed for me. They know it is a compassion. I tell you, even this is not complete 100% compassion. I don't know how you will understand. If you feel that you are needed, that is something, the extraordinary coming down, the incarnation, avatar. Krishna was able to do that. Krishna has done it. There are some extraordinary expressions. Of each masters, I can say this is the most extraordinary expression which did not happen in any other incarnation. If you see galaxy of enlightened masters, Uma knows, Parvati knows. She is around Shiva because of Shiva's compassion. Shiva does not need. Shiva's pleasure or joy is not added even 1 inch more by Parvati. But Radha knows she is needed for Krishna's joy. Krishna yearns for her presence. Ultimate respect given to the human beings. Ultimate sacrifice done by the incarnations. This sacrifice is the ultimate sacrifice done by any incarnation happened on the planet Earth. He is not sitting in the pedestal and saying, I am compassionate, I am giving my love to you. No. He is pressing the feet of Radha and painting her feet with mehendi. You can't imagine. And rishis were very angry. You are an incarnation, you forget your original space and pressing a feet of a cowherd girl from Barsana Dham. Barsana Dham is a village from which the Radhika, Radha Rani, took birth. That village is supposed to be the low caste people's village. So like in the small communities, they have villages allocated for the low caste community. So this Barsana Dham is supposed to be the low caste community village. The rishis are screaming, how dare you will press a cowherd girl's feet? Have you fallen from your state? It's a disgrace to an incarnation. Maybe those days most watched scandal. The sex can be so possessive, so intoxicating, even an incarnation lost his grace and pressing the feet of a cowherd girl from a Barsana Dham outcasted village. Only Krishna knows the extraordinary sacrifice and the extraordinary grace. The intellectual rishis can never understand, can never catch it, can never catch it. I can say, the sacrifice of Shiva drinking the poison alahala to save the world, the sacrifice of Buddha, his newborn son and his wife, for the sake of achieving and radiating enlightenment to the world, the sacrifice of Ramakrishna accepting the karmas of the many disciples and giving up his own body in the throat cancer, the sacrifices done by Andal, Meera, Prahlada, Jnanasambandar, Tirunavukkarasar, Jesus, all these great different incarnations, everything is smaller than this one sacrifice of Krishna painting the feet of Radha with mehendi and pressing her feet. That is the ultimate conscious coming down. Understand? An incarnation is great based on his ability to come down, not based on his powers expression. No. For that, you don't need to take human body. Sit in your Akshardham and show all your drama and magic and miracle. Get out. Understand? See, to show extraordinary powers, he can kill Gamsa, he can kill Shishubala, he can lift Govardhana. You don't need to come down to human earth. Be there in your Vaikuntha. From there, just make a wish and it is done. That is not the purpose of an incarnation. Incarnation's greatness is defined by his ability to land to the lowest possible mood. Greatness is expressed by the landing, descending. That is why incarnation, not by his ability to show extraordinary powers. But again and again, the foolish humanity, which is enchanted, enchanted, mesmerized by the glories and filled with greed for powers, recognizes and respects the masters only who are expressing extraordinary powers, forgets the great sacrifice of landing. My greatness is not making you levitate, but making this body walk on the earth. I sacrifice more to make this body walk on the earth than to make you fly. To make you fly, I don't need to assume this body. My space sitting there is enough. Come on, fly, you will fly. Making this body walking on the earth is my bigger sacrifice than making you fly. I'll tell you the story from Krishna's life to explain attachment. Narada, those days news reporter, comes down and sees Krishna pressing the feet of Gopi Radha and putting mehendi, got completely annoyed and prepares a scandalous report. Maybe some video also. But after all, he's a rishi. So before releasing it, he wanted to have one interview, direct interview with Krishna. As, are you caught in Maya? What is going on? I am going to circulate this report to all the three worlds. Krishna lost his enlightenment. Krishna smiles and says, do you know about Maya? Narada says, I know. Krishna says, no, you don't know. Then Narada says, come on, show me. Krishna says, I am feeling thirsty. Can you just get me a little water? Narada goes to Yamuna to get water. Suddenly on the banks of Yamuna, Narada sees a beautiful woman, falls in love, asks her to marry. She also marries. Both of them move to the other side of Yamuna and start living happily. 100 years over. One day suddenly huge flood in Yamuna. So Narada is trying to move to a safe place. His house is washed, everything is lost. He is just trying to cross Yamuna by holding his beautiful wife and the child and some of his properties on the head by swimming. Slowly in the current, first properties goes away. Narada is crying. Then slowly in the little more current, the one child is lost. He is crying, weeping. After a few moments, one more child gone. Now he is left alone with his wife. He is trying his best to swim and reach a safe place. Suddenly in the whirl, heavy current, the wife also lost the balance and he has lost the wife also. He is crying by intense breaking. Then suddenly he hears the voice, Narada, where is my water? He wakes up. That's all. He listens to the voice of Krishna. Narada, where is my drinking water? Still I am thirsty. Narada just wakes up. Oh God. Krishna, this is your maya. Leave me. Have this report under you, at your feet. I am going. And he touched not only the feet of Krishna and the feet of Radha. O Raseshwari, let me not be caught in maya anymore. Let me be at your feet. Leave me. Blessed is Narada, who really wanted to have one last interview with Krishna before publishing the scandal. Attachment. Maya. If you sit in this seat and see what you will be seeing, and now what I am seeing, the only reason for these two different scenes, see, in the same place, if you sit, you will see something. But in the same place sitting, I am not seeing the same thing. I am seeing something different. If you want to see what I am seeing, only thing you need to do is remove the attachment, that's all. The only difference is attachment, nothing else. Even while all of you are not there, when there were bars in front of me, I was in the same mood because there is no attachment to all of you. Understand? Whether it is number of disciples or number of steel bars, did not create any disturbance because there is no attachment inside. Now two processes. One, understand this Narada story. Do not let thoughts become engrammed. That's the process now we are going to do. Today, that is why I put you all in the process of diluting the engrams into thoughts. All of you went through. It's a very powerful process. Diluting thoughts into, sorry, engrams into thoughts by removing attachment. Catharsis. Catharsis. Now sit without making thoughts into attachment. That's the process now. Thoughts into engrams by attachment. Neither yes nor no to anything happens in your biomemory. This is the first process. After you finish this process and go out, second is not process, declaration of truth. Swarajya Siddhi, reclaiming your kingdom. Aham Brahmasmi, I am enlightened. To around the world. And I tell you, I have a guts, energy, intelligence, and everything to make my words into reality. Even if all your levers are not accepting, unconditional. So it is time we move into this process. After all, you are enlightened. You don't need anything much. Just now you are going to taste your enlightenment. That's all. Understand? You are not going to do any process for enlightenment. You are going to taste your enlightenment. Just feel how it feels. Come on. Now I am sitting without converting my thoughts into engram with attachment. Let me see how the enlightenment feels really in my tongue. So now you are going to taste your food, which is your own property, your own, that's the word, no other word can be added, your own. I can say we're getting to the tasting ceremony. It is not process, it's like a tea ceremony. Now, just like how they say in Zen tea ceremony, so e-tasting ceremony, enlightenment tasting ceremony. Now, let's taste our enlightenment, how it feels. How it feels when we sit without converting thoughts into engrams, by not having attachment. That's all. So, neither I need to bless you, nor I need to pray to somebody to bless you. Let us all bless ourselves. That we will all taste our enlightenment. That's all. See, we all have a deep humbleness to submit when great truths happen in our inner space. And we all have a great courage to live and taste our enlightenment. Our courage and humbleness does not crash or hit each other. They are in tune with each other. Our courage is not ego. Our humbleness is not fear. So, let's all bless ourselves. To live and radiate enlightenment, to live and radiate the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you.
take all that's left.